Peace be with you.
And also with you.
It is good to be together on this day, otherwise known as Eclipse Day Eve. And we are so glad to see all of you and to be together, those of you who are here in person.
I'm really impressed people made it through the traffic jam of the 300,000 people who are in town. That's really good.
And when they start arriving later today, everyone's going to blame you. But we are so glad you are here, and especially if you are a visitor, you are joining us for the first time, we are especially glad that you are here. I'm Mary Beth Morgan.
I'm Jimmy Moore.
And we serve as the pastors here at St. Mark's United Methodist Church in Bloomington, Indiana. And from wherever you are coming, if you are joining us here or on live stream, we are one community of faith on this day. If you are joining us in person, you may have noticed, if you're sitting at the end of a row, that there is a red booklet, and that's an opportunity for you to sign in to let us know you're here if you've had any changes of information. If you are joining us on live stream at 10:30 on Sunday morning, and you are doing so by computer, you also have the option of a chat function. That is an opportunity for you to share a word of peace with others who are also on chat and helps us know that you are here. And either way, at the corner of your screen, there's also a QR code that will help you to sign in and to let us know that you're here.
So we are very, very glad that you're here. Mary Beth, the little birdie told me that Mark Cox is joining us online this morning. So hello to Mark and everyone else who is there. I have a couple of things just to let you know about. First, the building and grounds are closed tomorrow. You know why. And does anyone here old enough to remember going to a movie and being given 3D glasses? Well, we don't have those. But what we do have are solar eclipse glasses so that you could view the eclipse, viewers, so you could view this safely tomorrow.
Directions are on the back.
And there, you may get those. If you didn't get them when you come in, the ushers will tell you they're on the tables as you leave. Take some, take more than one because we have plenty. And then on the April 17th, the Sing for Joy concert, that's a Wednesday at 6 p.m. This is a choir of differently abled people. It's going to be accompanied by the Bloomington Jazz Orchestra Combo. It's going to be great. I'm looking forward to that very much.
And also, just a reminder and maybe some new information for some, that those who volunteer at Hoosier Hills Food Bank each month, they're going to meet this time on April 15th from 3 to 4:30. And so they just moved the date, and so please be a part of that. And also to let you know that from now until April 12th, our Appalachia Service Project team is accepting donations. You may have seen a bin in Garten Hall if you are here in person. They will be leaving on April 21st. For their service trip to Johnson City, Tennessee, and they are specifically looking for individually packaged snacks like chips and pretzels and things like that, and bottled water or sports drinks. If you could please have them in Garten Hall by April 20th, that would be great.
So, quick before the eclipse happens, may you stand as you're able. Children, come down to this table, grab a chime, and chime us back into worship. We invite the rest of you to pass the peace of Christ.
And wave to the people at home. Hi, Mark.
Hi.
You too. Great.
Thank you. We'll invite you to stand as you are able for our call to worship, our gathering hymn, and our affirmation of faith. The heavens declare the glory of God, and the earth shows forth the divine handiwork.
The rising and setting of the sun and the cycles of the moon define our days and nurture our spirits.
When our universe shifts in predictable patterns, even briefly, we notice, some sense wonder, others feel dread.
Tomorrow's eclipse draws our attention to our natural world. What shall we learn?
All of creation, including its variations, invite us to find our praise and to catch up to the unique moving of the divine Creator.
Let us offer our morning praise to God, who stretches the heavens and who shines glory in the darkness and light.
Thank you.
As your comfort and conscience allow, let us share in an affirmation of faith. Let us say what we believe. We believe that God creates all things, renews all things, and celebrates over creation. We believe Earth is a precious sanctuary, a sacred planet filled with God's presence, a home for us to share and to care for. We believe that Jesus fully entered our world. Now risen Christ is at the center of creation, reconciling all things to God. We believe the Spirit renews life all around us and groans in empathy with the suffering creation. This Spirit works lovingly with us for the renewal of creation. You may be seated, and we would invite the children to come forward for a children's moment.
Try it again. Good morning, everybody.
Good morning. Good morning.
Thank you. What a great group. I've just got a question for you. You know what it is. What's going to happen tomorrow?
The solar eclipse.
The solar eclipse. Are you sure?
Yeah.
Okay.
I'm 100%.
100%. So what is a solar eclipse? Jeremiah has a hand up. Okay.
It's going to happen in three countries, Mexico, North America, and Canada.
Wow. Jeremiah, way to go. Yeah. A ton of people are going to visit Bloomington. That's what we think.
Hundreds of
Yeah, that's right, because...
From different countries.
Yeah. Back there. Do you remember? Well, God, I see you. Okay, you go ahead.
It's when the moon and the earth and sun line up, and then the moon blocks the sun's light complete.
Okay.
It looks like the earth has like it looks like the moon has is like it looks like the moon is like on a plate.
So if you're excited about the eclipse, raise your hand. Yeah, we're all pumped about the eclipse. So what's going to happen? What's it going to look like, do you think, when it happens? Yeah.
It's going to get dark.
It's going to
get like almost pitch black.
Almost pitch black. Is that right, Jeremiah? The more you talk, the cooler it sounds to me, Jeremiah.
Yeah,
Mary Beth, what do you think about tomorrow?
It's going to be like a ring of fire.
I like a ring of fire.
Well, right? I think one thing that's amazing, and it's possible that somebody in this group knows here or out there, how many years ago was it that it was here around Bloomington? How many years ago was the last time we had that happen? Okay. More than 20. Jeremiah?
365.
Okay, it was a long time, but and in different places, it would have been that far, but it was like 155, yeah. So you know what we're going to do? When we go to Sunday school, we're going to share the answer, and then we're going to let all of them know. How about that?
All right.
I'll bet you
55. Okay.
You know, here's the thing, Jeremiah,
Sadly, no, the United Methodist Church isn't pro-gambling, so we're going to be
okay. You may not have taught this at church at home, but we're not supposed to gamble at church.
That's right, I know.
Just got it.
Yeah,
the bishop may be watching, and I just
want to say that.
So here's the deal. Here's the deal.
But I think the thing is that it was so long ago around this area that nobody who is here would have been here. So when we see this eclipse, we have to think about that, that it's going to be like there'll be people asking us when we're older, whatever older is, they are going to be asking us, what was it like then?
Very cool.
And that's the really cool part.
Mary Beth, would you like to offer a prayer?
Let me, God, we thank you for the gift of creation, the creation that makes us say, wow, that makes us realize how special we are and how we are loved and how we are to care for the earth and for all that grows on it and for all the people who live on it, if they are close to us or around the globe. Be with us in our time of Sunday school, in our time of worship, and in our time together as community. Amen.
Amen.
All right. Well, we have like quite a crew today because we have Kevin and we have Tori and we have Steven. So like it doesn't get better than that. And I get to come and hang out with you too. So this is going to be really fun. And so we're going to go to Sunday school. And I think what we're going to do is we're going to start in Garten Hall and you might have something musical for us. That's what I thought. So, not that we're planning on the spot or anything, but we know what we're doing. So we're going to start in Garten Hall. We're going to do some singing. We're going to do some other things, and then we're going to talk a little bit more about eclipse things, but also talk about scripture reading.
Okay.
So we're looking forward to that.
Thank you all.
Here we go.
If you thought the sun had energy, you should be in Sunday school today. It's going to be great. We want to move into our time of prayer requests today, and we do have some to bring you. We prayed for Lloyd Lamb, the husband of Rayetta Lamb, last Sunday, and Lloyd died on Monday. And his service was this week, so do pray for Rayetta and this concern. We had a service here yesterday for Mary Ellis Stout, a lovely service, and the choir and the chamber singers from the Chamber Singers were there because she was a founding member of the Chamber Singers. So do pray for this family. And we also, this coming Saturday at 2 p.m. in the sanctuary, there is memorial service for Pat Scheidler. So those of you who know this family, we love the Scheidlers and we pray for them. Today, I'm asking you to pray for Susie Rimstedt, who is in the hospital and is experiencing some heart issues, and they're deciding on some treatment options. She may be going home today. I'll be checking on her after service today, but do pray for Susie. Continue to pray for Trish Martin, Bruce Martin, Flo Davis, Jan Foster, Dan Hughes, Max Meunier, Nancy Rusnick, John and Carolyn Drake, Ann Hutchinson and two daughters, Judy Hall, Liz Collins, Diana Hall, Tom Hedges, Peggy Goodhoyle, Joan McAvoy, Martin, who's Peggy's son, Cheryl Wolf, Linda Glough, Dennis Mood, Deborah Jones, Mike Yost, Carrie Lawrence. And then these more confidential requests for Jenny, Matt, Gunner, A.H., Kay, Julie, Kip I., Tom, Jordan, Carol, Jeremy, Sue, Laura, David, Kim, Phyllis, Charles, Sheila, Matisse, Cillian, Allie, Laura, and Kay. I want to just share a bit of a reading from Sojourner Truth, who many of you know was an early preacher and abolitionist who helped people escape through the Underground Railroad. And she tells this story from her childhood that her mother would say to this, that her mother would sometimes sit outdoors in the evening, look up in the stars, and groan So I say to her, "Mama, why are you groaning so?" She says, "I groan to think of my poor children because they've been taken. They don't know where they are. I don't know what they are. We all look with the stars, but we can't tell where each other is." Now she says to her child, to me, "You're going to be grown up and you may be sold away and have great troubles. And when you have those troubles, just go to God. He'll help you." And I say to her, "Who is God anyhow, Mama?" And she says, "Child, just look up. It's the God who made those stars you're looking at." The prayer is inspired, if you will, by the 19th Psalm. "The heavens are telling the glory of God, and the firmament proclaims his handiwork. The Lord be with you." Let us pray. Loving One, as we sit together, even in pauses and moments of silence, even when we are singing or praying or preaching, more than one message is going forth. Words are being spoken. A song is being sung. Because the heavens are proclaiming your glory. The earth is declaring your might and goodness. In the daytime, in the nighttime, your praise is being offered. So when we pray, while we may feel that it was all our idea, our response to a kindness or our reply to some distress, there is another impulse that precedes that, that causes us to bring to you our gratitude and praise, our requests for ourselves, our intercessions for others. The heavens are telling us of your glory, sometimes reducing us to tears, sometimes thrilling us beyond measure, sometimes allowing us moments of sheer wonder. The heavens are telling of your glory, and the earth is singing its song. And this season, we join our Easter hallelujahs with that, proclaiming that death is overcome, that Christ is risen. The heavens are telling your glory, and in the depths of our being, we search for words to help us know how to tell you what we need. We love people who are ill, some who mean everything to us. We pray that this glory will come to their aid. We surround those, literally and in our hearts, who are grieving ones they have lost, who long to know not only the glory of the heavens, but the glory of resurrection. We remember those this day who are hungry, who are thirsty, who are discouraged, who are desolate, who are in harm's way, whose lands are torn apart by war, who want to know if the beauty of the heavens can heal their land. May it be so. May our hearts be opened. Now hear us as we pray in our silence. We are grateful that you hear us always. Hear us now as we join our voices together and pray as Jesus taught disciples of all ages to pray, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen."
Good morning. Today's passage is from Joel, chapter 2, verses 18 through 32. Joel is a very short book. You can read the whole thing in about 15 minutes or less. And it begins with the words, "The word of the Lord that came to Joel, son of Pethuel." And that's about all we know about Joel and the time he lived in, which is to say, not much at all. There are locusts in today's reading. A lot of destructive locusts who invade Israel and devastate the land. eat its crops, invade its cities, destroy the countryside. The locusts are sent by the Lord to, at the least, get the attention of the Israeli people or to punish them for losing their way. The Lord, Joel says, will have a change of heart and protect the land and kill the locusts and provide new crops and nourishment to the people and the countryside. You can tell from the sermon's title that this selection likely was chosen because there are verses that mirror tomorrow's eclipse, and they are apt and beautifully written. But the locust narrative also mirrors a phenomenon that we will be experiencing in our part of the country. At the end of this month, when two broods of cicadas, 1 trillion of them, will emerge to live and mate and die. That's a lot of cicadas. And none of us has ever experienced anything like it. When these broods last emerged at the same time, Thomas Jefferson was our president. So here are two things that may help us follow Joel's locusts. He refers to the locust as the northerner because it is from the north that Israel's enemies typically invaded the country. So locusts equal enemies. The Lord will kill the locusts, and the insects' bodies will lie on the land from the eastern sea, that's the Dead Sea, all the way to the western sea, that's the Mediterranean. And the dead insects will stink. That's what he says. It's in the book. So here we are, chapter 2 of Joel, verses 18 through 32, in the translation by Robert Alter. Here goes. And the Lord, and let the Lord be zealous for his land and show mercy for his people. And the Lord answered and said to his people, I am about to send to you new grain and new wine and oil, and you will be sated with them. And I will no more make you disgraced among the nations. And the northerner I will put far from you and scatter him to a parched and desolate land, his face to the eastern sea and his end to the western sea. And his stench shall go up, and his foul odor go up, for he has done enormities. Do not fear, O land. Exult and rejoice, for the Lord has done enormous things. Do not fear, O beast of the field, for the wilderness meadows sprout grass, and the tree yields its fruit. The fig tree and the vine put forth their wealth, and children of Zion, exult and rejoice in the Lord your God, for he has given you the early rain as bounty and brought down the rain for you, early rain and latter rain as before. And the threshing floors shall fill with grain, and the vats overflow with new wine and oil, and I will pay you back for the years that the grasshopper ate, the swarmer, the grub, and the locust, my great force that I sent against you. And you shall eat, be continuously sated, and you shall praise the name of the Lord your God, who has done wondrously for you. And my people shall not be shamed evermore. And you shall know that I am in the midst of Israel, and I am the Lord your God. There is none else. And my people shall not be shamed evermore. And it shall happen afterward. I will pour my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Your elders shall dream dreams. Your young men see visions. And even upon male slaves and slave girls, in those days will I pour my spirit. And I will set portents in the heavens and on earth, blood and fire and columns of smoke. The sun shall turn into darkness and the moon into blood before the coming of the day of the Lord, great and fearful. And all who call in the name of the Lord shall escape, for on Mount Zion there shall be a remnant, as the Lord has said, in the survivors whom the Lord calls. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Tom. So Tom said you could read the book of Joel in about 15 minutes, which is about how long I plan to preach. So maybe he was just saying, if you wanted to, you could read the book of Joel instead of listening to the sermon. I'm not sure if that's what you were saying. I want to tell you a story about a man named Laverne Beiser. You probably have heard his name this week. He is 105 years old. He lives in Fort Worth, and he has an addiction. He does not smoke. He does not drink. He does not take drugs, and he never has. But if he went to a recovery group, he would say, "Hello, my name is Laverne, and it's been 4 years since my last eclipse." He has seen 13 total solar eclipses. His wife just died last year. They were married over 75 years. This is the first solar eclipse he will ever have seen without her. But he says, once you see one, you have to see them all. And he organized his life. I mean, early on, he built airplanes. Then after he retired, he learned how to build telescopes, including the grinding of the mirror, which he said could take weeks or months. So he is a very, very patient and very determined person. So much so that in 72, when his daughter was getting married, she gave him two dates in June. He said, "The first one will work. The second one, I'm going to an eclipse." He did this because something in that experience of the totality of the eclipse is really impossible to replicate. There are those, I use that word, addiction, in part because Kate Russo he's written three books about the eclipses, has seen 11 herself, says it is really quite like that. She said, in those moments of totality, everything changes. It is impossible to describe. It is not likely to ever be forgotten. And she said, "I organized my life partly to go visit where the eclipse is happening." Now, I wonder what your plan is tomorrow. I don't know how many people will be here tomorrow. Maybe like locusts, they'll just take the place over time. I don't know. But I think most of us are intrigued by what's going to happen. Most of us are aware that in those 4 moments, something is happening. But imagine for a moment. I've been wrestling with the language around this. Imagine you're a pre-scientific person. I say that because there's always been science, and it may not have been Copernican, right? It may not have viewed the Earth at the center, the sun at the center of the universe, or it may not have viewed that the Earth was spherical. But there has always been science. But just imagine, you know every day that the sun's going to rise, the sun's going to set, and unless it's cloudy, it's going to be bright. Every single day, that's going to happen. And then somehow, and eventually, by the way, since around the time of Christ, those who are close to what we would call scientists have been able to tell when an eclipse was going to happen by based on when they'd had before, by studying the heavens. But when that happens, you're an ancient person. And your world all of a sudden grows dark in a way that you have never seen it grow before. You didn't have protective lenses. You just knew in that moment that you could see stars in the middle of the day. And you did not know what was going on. So one way to talk about this is to say there is a pre-scientific world or a pre-enlightenment world. There's an enlightenment world. And there's a post-enlightenment world, post-modern world, as we're saying we're in now. So if you were in a pre-scientific world and you were a person of faith, you would say, the sun comes up because God makes the sun come up. God just moves it over the earth. God does that. When you become an enlightenment person, then you have to know why it happens. Well, there's this whole gravity thing. There's this whole earth spinning around the world thing. The world is also rotating on its own axis. And so there are, in the Enlightenment, we wanted to know why things happened. And part of what happened, not for everyone, part of what happened in the Enlightenment mind is that the desire to explain eclipsed, see what I did there? Eclipsed the capacity to know wonder, but not for everyone. Even Immanuel Kant, the heart of Enlightenment thinking, would say two things caused me to wonder. When I look at the stars in the heavens, and when I see the moral law in my heart. But for us who live in this world, it doesn't mean we do away with the explanation. Paul Ricoeur talked about a second naivete. Before scientific thinking, we, the world, may have been a little bit naive about some things, about how things happen. Then thinking, scientific thinking comes, and we're not naive anymore. But he would say there comes a third point where there is a second naivete, where you don't erase all the scientific knowing, but you still see wonder, divinity, even God in the midst of it. So when this happens to you tomorrow, I'm wondering where your mind will go. I'm wondering where your heart will go. I am wondering, as a pastor, tomorrow, will you see the divine in what's happening? Let's go to Joel. Tom told us a lot about Joel. We don't know really much about him. People guess at a several hundred year span when he could have been ministering. What we know is that he was a prophet. One of the prophets in the scriptures. He looked at the people of God with concern. Like every one of those prophets, Walter Brueggemann tells us, he had two kinds of energies. He had a critiquing energy to say, you know, you're in the mess you're in. You're in exile because you have been covenantally unfaithful. And there are consequences. They may be locusts, they may be exile, there may be something, but at the heart of the consequence is a distance from the God you proclaim you are worshiping. But then he would say, Brueggemann would say, there is an energizing spirit as well, which says you do not have to stay there. You can see a different reality happen for you. Brueggemann would say that the prophets carried about this sense of the way things were, but they had within them, because the Spirit of the Lord was in them, an alternative reality to which they were pointing people. Now, what I want to suggest, and have your fun, seriously, it is incredibly cool what's going to happen tomorrow. I'm praying for clouds, those out there, to go somewhere else. It is incredibly cool. But also consider this, that what is happening tomorrow has the deep potential to be a sacred moment for you. And when sacred moments happen, we hope they happen in this room. We hope they happen in your engagements with people that you love. We hope they happen when you hear or sing that piece of music that opens you like you have never been opened before. We hope you see. I remember one. This is not about football. Peyton Manning was my favorite football player. His dad, I grew up watching him at Ole Miss. Heard one day that Peyton Manning was going to make $18 million. Now, for athletes now, that's chump change, right? Not quite, but you know what I mean. The day after, the hours after I heard that, I went and made a visit at the nursing home. And I saw a woman on staff feeding someone who could not feed themselves. I said two things to myself. I'm pretty sure she doesn't make $18 million a year. And what I am watching is one of the most lovely, graceful, wonderful things I've ever seen in all of my life. Tomorrow invites us, today invites us, to develop a capacity for wonder, to be opened in such a way that we can believe that a reality can be other than the reality that we know, that someone who is addicted can shake that addiction, that someone who is full of rage can find a peaceful heart, that a land right now that knows indiscriminate and unnecessary destruction and death can find peace. I am praying for you and for me that tomorrow and today, that there are sacramental moments that open us to a very different reality. So, Barbara Kingsolver, have you ever read her work? Incredible writer. She tells a story in an essay she wrote. The essay is called Small Wonders. She said it takes place in northern Iran. There are people who wonder if this actually took place. But a family from a village was playing with their kid, and they lost track of their child, and it got to be dark, and they couldn't find their child. And they knew in the nearby countryside were bears. And they were worried. So they organized search parties to go all out into the region to look for this baby. And they looked and they looked and they looked and they couldn't find it. And all of a sudden they came upon a cave and someone said, "I smell bear." And they also heard the whimpering of a child. And she said in the story that they looked inside that cave. And to their great surprise, they saw a huge bear cradling, nursing that child. And she said, you can say to yourself, that's impossible. Or you could say to yourself, that story says to us, sometimes nature, unpredictable nature, will make warm bodies attract to other warm bodies. And if anything is happening tomorrow, warmth is being attracted to warmth. Light is being attracted to darkness, and heart is being attracted to heart. Annie Dillard said in an essay that she wrote called Solar Eclipse, she has a long story about this eclipse that she and her partner went to a visit in the mountains. She said, but as soon as totality stopped, people started jumping in their cars and racing down the mountain. And she said, there was still a partial eclipse. People would drive miles and miles to see a partial eclipse, but because totality had ceased to be, they left. And she said, how is it that we are so ready to leave the experience of wonder? A person of wonder in my life, I've told you about him before, is named Reginald Barnard, long since gone. He was my teacher in theology at the first seminary I attended. People should not have to use first, second, and third for seminaries. I'm sorry, it just happened. He's from Australia, studied in Britain. Oh my goodness, such a poetic man. And I remember, he said, remember when Joel says, the sun shall turn to darkness and the moon shall turn to blood? Maybe that's about locust time. Something in me thinks that's about solar and lunar eclipses, because what do we call lunar eclipses? Blood moon, right? But he said, it became the tradition among people of Hebrew faith when a beloved rabbi had died to say, our sun has turned to darkness and our moon has turned to blood. In other words, our very life has been changed. And it could be the critical change in which things get rough, or it could be the blessed change in which those who call upon God will find God. And so it reminded me, when I remembered that story this week, of Mitch Albom's book, Have a Little Faith, in which his rabbi calls him in one day. He's a reporter, if you don't know his writings, really good writer, and says to him, I want to ask you to do me a favor. I want you to do the sermon at my funeral. And he said, I didn't know what to say. He said, I realized later, because I had to meet with him every week, that was his rule. He said, I realized this was his way of getting me back in synagogue, so that's fine, but it worked. He said, but I got to know him. I got to know this incredible, incredible man. And when he preached that sermon, he said, imagining you, Reb, without the world in it is like imagining a world with a little less God in it, and yet God is not a diminishing resource. I cannot believe that. Instead, I have believed that you have melted, that God has melted the sky. Scratch. God has melted you back into his glory. Your soul is like a return favor. You are a star in his sky and a warm feeling in our hearts. We believe that you are with God, with your forefathers, with your daughter, with your past, and at peace. May God keep you. May he sing to you and you to him. We look up when you have been trying, good sweet man of God, to get us to look all along. We look up. Mayor Oliver writes, what I want in my life is to be willing to be dazzled, to cast aside the weight of facts, maybe even to float a little bit above this difficult world. I want to believe I am looking into the white fire of a great mystery. I want to believe that the imperfections are nothing, that the light is everything, that is more than the sum of each flawed blossom rising and fading. And I do. Tomorrow, when you look up carefully with glasses, may you see in your heart the white light of the divine wonder, and may it bless you. Amen. We are so grateful for the ways this congregation offers in so many ways, gifts to this church, gifts of music, gifts of taking care of children, gifts of taking care of this property, gifts of serving on all kinds of committees, and financially. You are faithful, and we are blessed because of that. The ushers will now come and receive your tithes and offerings. pray together, loving God, we are grateful for the wonders of your creation. You call us to share our time, talents, and resources to care for the earth and skies and all of your beloved children. May we do so with gratitude and joy. Amen. You may be seated. Those who are helping serve communion, please come to the chancel area. Just form a line circle behind me, semicircle. As they're coming, let me just give some guidance here. First, you are welcome, as your conscience is allowed, to share in this meal with us. If your church member is someone else, somewhere else, that's perfectly fine. We invite you to take. We'll take primarily by intention. There'll be servers along the front. You can take a piece of bread and dip in the cup. If you are a little more needing to watch health today, we'll have some individual elements down front. There is also the only gluten-free station is also down front. There are these two purple baskets on that table. We try to, every time we do communion, collect an offering for those with emergency financial need during this month. And you're invited, whether you come to the table or not, to share in doing that. I will just say that as the servers are stretched across the front, if you're in a line and you see an empty station, just please do go to that. That will just help us move through this time very well. I will also note that there will be a roving station if you want to be served where you are. Raise your hand. The ushers will point the roving station to you, and you'll receive there at your seat. The gifts of God are given to the people of God. Diane.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right, O Lord, to give our thanks and praise this day. Creator God, you made the sun to shine in the day and the moon by night. The earth in all her glory responds with a greening that prepares us for the shifting season and allows the sea to move in its dynamic way. And occasionally, the sun and the moon darken, opening to others wonders of our universe. In all these things, you have made us for goodness, truth, and beauty. In this world, we are called to be disciples of the one who is alive forevermore, and who is the very bread of life for us. And so, with your people on earth, O Lord, and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth full of your glory, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord, Hosanna in the highest.
So at this table, we remembered when Jesus gathered with disciples. Passover evening, that evening, he took bread and he broke it, telling them this was the bread of life, broken for them, remembering him in those moments. He also took a cup and said, this cup is the cup of the new covenant, poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. When you do this, remember me. So in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, O Lord, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as holy and living sacrifices in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died.
Christ is risen.
Christ will come again. So Lord, pour out your Spirit on these gifts and make them be for us the very presence of Christ, leading and empowering us to be your presence in the world as well, wherever we find ourselves. All honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever.
Amen.
I invite you to stand together as we sing our closing hymn. So good to be worshiping together. I hope you're careful when you leave. The traffic jams, I've seen 3 cars pass in the past 5 minutes, so it's just rugged out there. But what is not hype is what will happen tomorrow. Be safe, have fun, and know that your community of faith, even if we're not gathered, is connected. May God be with us today, may God be with us tomorrow, and with us forever. We leave this time and this place in peace, praying that the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the communion of the Holy Spirit will be with us all now and forever. Amen.